Okay. This is a rowdy group. Welcome, welcome. Hi. Thank you. I love having this in this such a wonderfully special room. You want to read them all, don't you? Well, no more pencils. One more book for your summer read. Chris Hodenfield has been my partner in crime, and we've wrote this whole book while we were laughing most of the time. You know, of course.
I never had more fun doing a book or anything as I have working with Dennis.
Yeah, so I'm going to read some of the book for you.
Well, what was fun about the book was I met the band. I traveled with Alice Cooper back, by the way, back in 72, so I got a chance to see what they were like back in those days. I wrote a story about it for Rolling Stone. And so what was fun about the book was going back to a time when the lines between hip and non-hip were pretty sharply drawn. And what they had to face, how would you describe your dress in those days? Where did you get your clothes?
We got them at thrift stores, but mostly in the women's section.
And you got, and so it was endless combat, starting with the Cowboys in Phoenix, and even when they got to Los Angeles, it was still pretty tough. So, there you go.
Nobody was transitioning.
Yeah, so they didn't want to see us coming. In 1967, record executives were still pretty much old school guys. They might have been ready to make a bunch of money off rock music for the kids, but their hearts were still waltzing in the gym to the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. We had an interesting face-to-face with an attitude at our next tryout. Michael arranged a meeting at a record company in downtown Los Angeles. To prepare, we went to our garage and recorded a demo on a cassette. The next day, we get to this towering black building where the security guard gives us a what in hell look. We found the record company on the top floor and Groucho walked through the door. We're from the IRS, Vince cracked. The receptionist managed to thaw out her face with a brief smile. After she notified her boss, we were allowed to go back into a chilly room lined with black granite. It was like a mausoleum. On the far side of the massive desk sat the executive. His facial expression was so severe, he should have been called Mr. Death. There we were in our thrift store regalia. There he was with platinum cufflinks shooting out of the sleeves of his black suit. His tan was the shade of a tainted orange. His shirt, tie, and glasses were all black. Judging from his expression, so was his heart. Michael handed our cassette to Mr. Death, who got up and slid over to a tape player that looked like a Lincoln Continental. He returned to his massive black leather chair and sat down. The chair emitted a resplendent fart. We might have laughed, but all of us were imagining ourselves being outfitted with cement overshoes. Mr. Death bowed his head and clasped his hands as if he were praying. He seemed to be sleeping or dead. Our songs boomed out in that forbidding in his office. The songs seemed extra crazy, but at least the high fidelity made them sound terrific. I got the feeling we were about to land a record deal. All we had to do was rouse Mr. Death from his frozen prayer. After the final note of our masterpiece, Mr. Death remained silent. A slight chair fart shook the room. Michael broke the ice. So what do you think? Mr. Death's hands lowered slowly. You want to know what I think? He said. You want to know what I think? He got up and ripped our cassette out of the Lincoln Continental and held it over his black granite wastebasket. He grabbed a black granite lighter from his desk and set our tape on fire. He dropped it, the flaming cassette, into the abyss of his wastebasket. The smell of burning plastic was in the air. Nobody spoke. We filed out like a chain gang. When the revolving door swept us out into the glaring sunshine of the street, Neil turned to give the building the finger. I was in disbelief that someone would destroy our music. There were a lot of spontaneous moments on that tape, I said. Now it's lost for good. Vince announced that he was going to treat this rejection with a stiff bottle of denial. We blew the rest of the afternoon at a table full of beers. So, these stories are true, but they're also the way that I remember them. They weren't really real as far as everyday life, because that's not a band in LA. LA wasn't real. And our band definitely wasn't living in this the reality of everyday life. When other people would be commuting to get to their jobs, we would be coming home, and everything was in a fantasy, and it was all in our head, and it was all a dream about what was to come. And all of those stories are in the book, and I had a lot of help from this gentleman right here. I met Chris in 1972. He came to the Alice Cooper mansion, and I'm going to let him tell you about that.
Well, I met them in the airport in Newark, and they were at the bar at 9 in the morning. And and one of the first stories he told me was that he was on the school paper, the tip sheet, back in at Cortez High. And maybe that's just what you tell a journalist on the road. But anyhow, I keep thinking of him as the sports writer from the paper. I mean, he has a memory for details. He remembers the story. So that's what made it fun. He has an appallingly good memory. I should say that. He not only remembers the kid, he not only remembers Herbert Clough from fourth grade, but that he wore orange socks on Thursday. I mean, there's very little he seems not to remember. So that makes him quite different. We know of a guitarist who traveled with a very big band, who confesses to us that there's a three-year period of the greatest fame that a guitarist could have, and he doesn't remember a bit of it. 3 years, gone. A black window in his basement. But Dennis remembers. It's really nice.
Still trying to forget.
Yeah. One of the great things about the Alice Cooper Band was that they were a bunch of comedians, and they were out to have a good time. I traveled with a lot of bands, and they're good time Charlie's out there. But each one of the guys in this band was trying to top the other in funny lines. It was like traveling with a vaudeville troupe. And so, and I think that came out in their shows. I could only think of another band, one other band, a British band called the Bonzo Dog Band. Hey, we got fans. Who were of that, just wanted to put on a show you're never going to forget. And so they, in the Peace and Love era, that you came up in, it was quite a pie in the face for a lot of the fans.
So you all remember that distinct image of Alice on the cover of Rolling Stone with the snake around his contorted face. Well, Chris wrote the story, and that's when we met, all the way back then. And so I knew that he was the right writer, because he was there and he had gone through a lot of the same, observed the era that we had gone through. And it worked out to be fun because we spent a lot of time hashing out stories that he was at the same place and similar things happened. So that really helped make the book a lot of fun because there wasn't much splaining to do. There was a lot of, because one of the important things I think that we wanted to touch on is that we had to put the story in the mentality of the era. The mindset was much different than it is these days. You know, what we did back then wouldn't be very shocking now, but back then it was really right on the edge and maybe just a little bit over the edge for where we would have been censored and nobody would have ever heard of anything that we did. So we had to keep pushing these boundaries that were set. But here we are. We've got this room full of wonderful people. We should ask them to give us some questions, right? Yeah.
Tell me about George Burns and Groucho Marx backstage at the shows. I heard they were big fans, and they compared the shows, the actors, to the vaudeville, like you mentioned earlier.
Yes, well, that happened when we were in Los Angeles, and I can see that because there was a lot of vaudeville in what we did, you know, a lot of Vincent Price and a lot of vaudeville, but you know, those guys were showmen, and that's what we wanted to be.
A lot of shows?
No, not a lot. They didn't come to a lot, but they only had to come to one, and now you're telling the story.
What about the generation gap, like, you know?
Well, it's showbiz, you know? It's still the same, basically. Yes?
Dennis, good to see you again.
Hi, JC.
Good to see you. I just want to thank you for the immense talent, all the great music, and the friendship over the years. It means a lot to me, and my question to you is, amongst the countless stories, what is your favorite Glenn Buxton story between you and him?
Well, not necessarily a specific story, but the one thing that I always really liked about Glenn that people never really knew about, that didn't know him closely, is how he liked the guy on the street. He liked the kid that just picked up a music book out of the record bin at Woolworths or something, and Glenn was ready to encourage them, or the guy that's pumping gas at the gas station. He really liked that because those people didn't, they weren't authority. Glenn didn't like people with rules. He didn't like birthdays because that meant everybody thought he should have to give somebody a gift. He'd give people gifts when they weren't expecting it, but he would never give you a gift if other people expected him to. So he was like that, and it was kind of the kid on the street kind of thing is what I really like about him, which, you know, he had a big heart. He had a heart of gold. He had a tough life, but a heart of gold.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, Dennis.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, it's okay. Sorry.
Paul.
How you doing?
Good.
As everyone here probably knows, you have one of the greatest marriages in all of rock and roll.
Where is she? Stand up, Cindy. There she is. Thank you. Thank you, Paul.
You can tell we're getting old when you talk about how long a marriage lasts. My question is, I went to see Peter Asher play at the Iridium, and he had talked about Paul McCartney dating his sister. There was a lot of amusing stories. So I'm sure the answer's in the book, but what was it like dating the drummer's sister?
Well, we were treading on thin ice, we thought, you know. I did not want to upset Neil, and I didn't want to do anything that might be a problem with the band. But wow.
The first time I saw you guys, you were at the Fillmore East, special guest stars, backing up Water Rock. And I'm pretty sure that was the only time you played the Fillmore, so I was just wondering what your experience was playing the Mecca Rock and how you got along with Bill Graham.
Bill Graham did not like us. I can't even tell you what he would say whenever we were around. Or whenever anybody mentioned Alice Cooper, I can't even say the words that he would say. And also, a lot, you notice on all of those posters, whenever we played the Fillmore, whether it was East or West, and we played fairly often, we were never the headliner, even though we really were. He always made a special guest because he said early on, your name will never be at the top of the bill. And we're like, okay, well, we're closing the show and the other bands are opening, so what are we doing here? but it was a mecca, and it's such a shame to not have places like that around anymore. And what he did, and it was really for the love of music and for the love of the music scene, he just didn't care for theatrics.
He was generous to his acts, but he found out from somebody on his staff who had been on his staff before that Bill Graham had a standing order: no food or drinks for these guys.
Yeah. In fact, hold on a second. Let's talk to Gail here. Stand up, Gail Ryan. I want to tell you, if there's anybody that kept the Alice Cooper organization, the wheels on the train, you know, this is her. And she worked for Bill Graham before she worked for us. Can you tell that story about the meeting?
I was a candy counter girl. I probably fed all of you Cracker Jacks at one point or another. On Saturday night, I was the show night receptionist. Kip Cohen was the general manager at the time, and he made a punch. was like Kahlua and three other liquors, and it was the best taste in chocolate milk I ever had. So I had a couple of those before the show started, and went out, and Friday night I had seen the show. And really, there was a lot of the ushers, the stagehands, everybody was like, I can't believe this band, I can't believe that band, why are they playing here? They're terrible. Meanwhile, I was like, after 3 years of seeing, hey, Bob Goulin, after 3 years of seeing every rock and roll band, every guy in tie-dyes and clogs and fringe, and to see Dennis running across the stage with a Swiss flag and someone else chopping up a watermelon and Alice ripping open a pillow and a CO2 cartridge blowing the feathers into the first. It was like, this is the best thing I've ever seen. So Saturday night came around and I'm already indulged in the punch in the office. And Mike Roswell, who was the road manager at the time, was coming. It's like, oh, I need another pass. I was like, pass? How many do you need here? You know, I was like, I love you guys. This is great. This is great. Meanwhile, I think I clearly was the only person on the whole staff that had that kind of reaction. So 2 months later, I was working for him.
But as Chris said, Bill was prided himself on how the backstage setup, all the food and all of the drinks and stuff.
There was catering backstage. There were flowers in all the dressing rooms. I know because I put them there. And it was really kind of forget this band is here. And I'm sorry, I couldn't, you know, sneaking things in, going, here, would you like another pass? Would you like another tray? So, but Bill was adamant. And I think actually one of the reasons why I started working was so that Shep could call Bill and go, I hired one of your girls.
Thank you, Gail.
Oh, you're welcome. Same here.
The way I heard the story is Bill said, I don't want them to even have a friggin' drink of water.
Gail was great. I mean, they needed straitjackets. So she calls up Bellevue. They say, well, where are you from? She says, oh, I'm from the Cooper Clinic.
The Bellevue said, we don't use straitjackets anymore. We use drugs. And we're thinking, well, we already do that.
I said, send the drugs. Where did you used to get the
straitjackets? Hi, Dennis. Thanks for doing this. I had a question. Obviously, you guys are known for the pretty bizarre and amazing things you did on stage. But for me, it's your bass lines that are so bizarre and beautiful. Really amazing. I'm just curious if you could sort of summarize what you were tapped into at the time that kind of inspired you to create, you know, these parts that nobody else could have ever thought of.
Well, early on, and thank you, you know, we learned from the British invasion. I mean, we learned Rolling Stones songs. I learned bass patterns, which were really American blues patterns, from Bill Wyman, listening to his records. And the Kinks and the Who and all of that. We emulated all of the British bands. But then the Yardbirds came along, and everybody always talks about how these guitar players were, how pioneering they were in the Yardbirds. Well, Paul Samwell Smith was just as pioneering on bass. And when I heard that, it wasn't like I want to play like him. It was like I heard that the bass could do anything that it wanted to do. And then that just opened the windows for me. And basically the way I looked at it is I wanted to weave in and out between the melodies of the guitars and maybe jump up to a harmony that another guitar was doing, but yet it always had to stay with the bass drum. And that wouldn't be as difficult if Neil wasn't also exploring and the bass drum pattern would change after I finally thought I got something. But there was a lot of give and take. Neil and I were very experimental, and it actually to the point of being a distraction in the rehearsal room at time, because he would be way out here doing something over here and I'd be doing something over there, and we wanted to try every possibility before. But as soon as we would start to lock in, I could always tell, because it started to feel like a locomotive was coming through the room. You can't By the way, you can't compliment a bass player without complimenting a drummer too, because it's a team. Neil Smith is the greatest. I work with a lot of great drummers. Albert Bouchard is the greatest. Thank you.
Hello, Dennis. I was 12 years old in 1975 when I bought my first rock and roll album, and school's out. My mom wouldn't let me go to any concerts, but too young. But I gave up listening to my mother's music, Neil Diamond, Carole King, and jumped right into the Alice Cooper. I've never been the same. So I just want to say thank you. I ended up getting involved in music, and I know that your music was a big influence in that. So I just want to say thanks. And I have a very quick question. I knew that you ran track in high school. Do you still run?
No, I type. In high school I ran the mile in 4:36. That was my best mile. And that same day I ran my best half mile, which was 2:06. So that's, you know, there were better high schoolers out in Arizona, especially Phoenix Indian School. The Indians would, some of them ran barefoot through the desert, but they were so good that we didn't even count them. The rest of the state would have a state meet, and Phoenix Indian School, their entire team would finish before anybody else in the state. But we were good. We won our division. Alice lettered when he was a freshman. I lettered. I was a three-year letterman. He was a four-year letterman. And we were undefeated in our division. So we ran a lot of miles together. During the summer when it was out of season for cross country, I'd run 3 miles to Alice's house. We'd play ping pong for a while, watch TV, and then we'd run 3 miles back to my house, and then he'd run 3 miles home. So we were that into it. It's probably from being out in that Arizona sun too long. Our brains were a little fried.
No wonder they're still going strong, though, right?
I think you're still on track today.
Hey, Dennis, how are you?
Hi.
Hi.
Max Greenberg. I'm Joe Greenberg's son.
Hi, Max.
I know he's here at heart with you. I just wanted to say I'm really proud of you for all your hard work. And I just had one question. Obviously, I was a fan. I saw the Golden Records in my house growing up. And, I saw the last couple Alice Cooper things, Super Duper Alice Cooper, the movie Super Mitch, and even, Behind the Music of Alice Cooper on VH1. As not only a fan, as a guy who, basically I lived, and my dad lived through that, obviously, and watching them, there was a bunch of lies in all those. A lot of important people were omitted. It has to feel really rewarding. I'm going to read the book. I can't wait to read the book. I don't even need to read it to know that it's based on 100% truth, and it gives credit to all the people that really made the name, made the band, made all the success. It's got to feel really rewarding to do that. And I just want to know how you feel.
Well, I'm with you. Your father is... was such a key part of it. Your dad is such a great guy. He worked really hard, as hard as anybody else, but nobody ever mentions him. Why is that? That does not make sense. It's like the Super Duper Alice Cooper movie, not mentioning Michael, not mentioning my wife as the designer of the clothing. And you can relate a little bit, because even in writing a book, I wrote this much, and it was edited down to an affordable book. So you have to leave things out sometimes, but it seems more like the repetition of this, the overlooking of your father's role. Your dad and Shep were partners, and they both worked equally as hard and made everything happen together. And I'm glad you're here. I hope you enjoy what I wrote about your dad.
Hey, Dennis. Nice to meet you. Obviously, I'm a fan of the Alice Cooper band, but I'm also a fan of the Battle Axe band. Whatever became of that band, it's a great record.
The band had... we had problems at the time. We had legal papers showing up in our mailboxes, and there were a lot of distractions. So... that was a big part of the problem. The other part of the problem is that we thought that was going to be the next Alice Cooper endeavor. And therefore, we built this gigantic stage, and we were kind of caught off guard, because when the record company all of a sudden wasn't there to pay for all of that, it was financially devastating. And emotionally devastating. So that's what happened to it.
Dennis, I actually have a question for you. Do you still play the song I'm 18?
Let's see, do I remember the song 18? I might need some help. Joe, can you show me how to play I'm 18? Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, for your listening pleasure.
Joe Bouchard. We've got Tish and Snooky, the darlings of the demented. We've got Albert Bouchard. You know them. You know their songs. Yes, absolutely. I'm going to grab my bass. Oh, wait. Testing, testing. I don't think I'm on. That's okay because I can't play. Oh, there we go. I can't play unless I have these on anyway. We're going to do a semi-acoustic version for you here. Let's hear it.
How you doing over there? Ready?
Yeah.
You ready? Got your harp?
Yeah, it's right here.
All right. 1, 2, 3, 4! My face and hands, lines form from his ups and downs. I'm in the middle of life. I'm a boy and I'm a man. Come on, see it. 18 and I don't know what I want.
18,
I just don't know what I want. Gotta get away.
I gotta get out of this place. Yeah. I'm gonna run it in outer space.
Yeah. Got a baby's brain and an old man's heart. Took 18 years to get this far. Don't always know what I'm talking about. Feels like I'm living in the middle of doubt. Cause I'm
18.
I don't know what I want.
18.
I just don't know what I want.
18.
I gotta get away. Gotta get away. My face and my hands, lines form on the left and right. I'm in the middle of life. Now I'm a boy and I'm a man. I'm 18 and I like it.
The question is, do you want the little ending? You want the slightly big ending, or do you want the big ending? Yeah.
Thank you.
Such a sweet, sweet thing to lay, got a hold of me. I opened doors for little old ladies, I helped the blind to see. I got no friends cause they read the papers, they can't be seen with me. And I'm getting real shot down and I'm feeling mean. No more Mr. Nice Guy, no more Mr. Clean, no more Mr. Nice Guy, they say, he's sick, he's a thief.
Yeah, that was the Alice Cooper group. It's too bad these guys didn't have any hits.
Well, I think we need a little bit of...
Oh!
Okay.
Now how are we going to do this? This will be a trick.
Dennis is ready.
That's the brother. That's the brother that's never ready.
All our times have come. Here, but now they're gone. Don't fear the reaper, to the wind, the son of the rain. We could be like they are. Come on, baby, don't fear the reaper.
Baby, take my hand.
Don't fear the reaper.
We'll be able to fly.
Don't fear the reaper.
Baby, I'm your man.
La, 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 la. La, 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 la,
now they're gone.
Together in eternity,
Romeo and Juliet,
the men and women every day.
Romeo and Juliet,
the men and women every day.
We define happiness.
A thousand coming every day.
It can be like they are.
Come on, baby,
don't fear the reaper.
Baby, take my hand.
Don't fear the reaper.
Will we ever fly?
Don't fear the reaper.
Baby, I'm your man.
La 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 la.
She couldn't go on, and the door was open and the wind appeared. Candles flew and then disappeared. Curtains flew and then he appeared.
And don't be afraid,
come on baby.
She had no fear.
She ran
and they started to fly.
They looked backward and said goodbye.
She had become like they are.
She had taken his hand.
She had become like they are.
Come on, baby, don't fear the reaper.
Albert Bouchard.
Thank you.
find the flag that don't suit you. That's a drag. School's out for summer. School's out forever. School's been blown to pieces. Think of a word to rhyme. School's out for summer. School's out forever. My school's being blown to pieces.
Shark!